So the question was, is there a function differentiable only at one point? So the answer is yes. And what I asked you, actually, maybe you thought you wanted a continuous function. That's a little bit that's a little bit harder. But here is the graph of that function. Just what you do is here, and the function is simply f of x equal to 0 if, let's say, x is rational, and minus x squared if x is irrational. That would work. You see where you have the derivative equal to 0 exactly at the origin. A harder question that the answer is also yes is to make the function everywhere continuous. Make sense? This is not everywhere continuous. It's continuous only at 0, right? Now, you can try to just play around with this megalodon function and modify it a little bit and see if you can make it differentiable only at one point. So basically, just maybe instead of having those serrated teeth, have one tooth that is parabola. Okay? All right. So what we covered today, it's I was considering, should I cover this or should I give you like a game where you have to say if something is true or false? Most questions are pretty silly, but I figured we don't have too much time, so let's do Arzela-Ascoli. Right? It's a little bit difficult. So the question that we are interested in is given compact set X, how do we recognize the compact subsets? Of the space of continuous maps over X. So the very first observation, in fact, it's already redundant because we did it several times. C of X is complete. So how do you prove that C of X is complete? You mimic the proof for the space of bounded functions. It's really actually exactly the same. So step one, pick a Cauchy sequence. Then the sequence is bounded by some M That's because it's Cauchy, it has to be bounded, nothing new. So therefore, we can construct a pointwise limit. Therefore, the absolute value of the function at some point is less than or equal to the norm of the function, which is less than m. And this implies that that fnx converges in R. With limit that I can denote by f of x. So this is the pointwise limit. So at each point x, there will be a limit for that sequence because it's bounded in R, and I'm just really calculating limits in R. Now step two is to show that the convergence is uniform. And we can do that like this. For epsilon bigger than zero, pick n bigger than zero such that if little m are bigger than capital N, that implies that in the norm this is less than epsilon. So from there we have fn x minus f of x. That would be just, you see, here I'm using just the pointwise limit. This is the same as limit where m goes to infinity of fn x minus fm x, which is less than or equal to limit as m goes to infinity of the supremum which is less than or equal to epsilon. So in this part you can see that there is no reference to x, so the convergence is uniform. X vanished, it's not important. Finally, step three. Why do we need to show uniform convergence? Because I need to verify that this f is continuous. How am I going to know that it's continuous? If I know it's uniformly convergent, then we prove the theorem to that effect. That if you have a sequence of uniformly convergent functions, then what they converge to is going to be a continuous function, provided each of those functions in the sequence are continuous.
Yes? What's the supremum ranging over? Because that is that you should.
The supremum is ranging over m. So what I do is, you see this limit, why do I put the supremum here is because I don't know that this converges. Right? I don't know that this absolute, that the thing is in this norm converges. It definitely becomes somewhat small, but do I know that it converges? Maybe it's within epsilon, but jumps around. If so, so thereby, if I introduce the supremum, I force the sequence to converge.
So is this the limb soup?
That's the limb soup.
Oh, okay.
That's the limb soup where fn is held constant, whereas m is pushed to infinity. Okay? That's an important part. It's only a technical matter. It's just that I want to make this smaller than something that doesn't depend on x and something that is small, vanishing. Okay? So what I showed is that this limit exists. How do I know it exists? It's a pointwise limit. For each x, we already know that it should exist. This sequence is pointwise Cauchy. Okay? So actually, all that I'm doing is we did it already like a few times, right? Just in different disguises. We talked about space of bounded functions and whatnot. So step three. Finally, from there it follows that we have uniform convergence. So now F is in the space of continuous functions because a sequence of uniformly convergent continuous functions must converge to a continuous function. So what does this show? It is enough. So it is enough to find a characterization of the totally bounded subsets. Of C of X. So here is where we have to be careful. Now, if F belonging to C of X is totally bounded family. By the way, in complex analysis, a totally bounded family is known as a normal family. So I once was going with my advisor, and he was talking about how he's going to introduce me to his family until I realized that he's only talking about the parameter family, right? He has a family, but I don't think it's as important as his normal family, right? So this thing, so when I speak about Arzela-Ascoli, right, I always have to take a gulp, right? Because it's already close to the thing that I came to almost dislike. I'm tortured with those families for like 3 hours. So this is a totally bounded family of functions. Then for every beta bigger than zero, this beta is our epsilon. I just used epsilon in another context, so I just replaced this thing here by another label. There are functions f1, fn belonging to f such that any f belonging to this family satisfies f minus f sub k less than this beta for some k. So what is this saying? So you see, each f is very similar to one of the fk's. So hence, each f in this family is very much like one of the f sub k's. So what does it mean? In particular, we have one since f is totally bounded. There is, or should I say, if it's totally bounded, it is bounded. F is bounded. And that means that there is a number and bigger than zero such that it's a bound that is bigger than every element in that set for all f in this family. So this is the obvious part. Two is the more subtle part. Each f belonging to this family has, and that's what I call in similar continuity properties. As one of f1 through fn. So by similar continuity properties, I mean, you see, this bound tells us that they are very similar, those two functions. So by similar continuity properties, what I mean is, if you think of them as water guns, right? So you have n types of water guns. And all the other types are going to be some cheap imitations of those finitely many water guns. Make some sense, right? So again, the fact that this is less than beta means that f and fk are very much alike. They're not quite the same, but very much alike. So everything about them is very similar. Okay? And I'm going to explain more precisely what are those similar continuity properties. That's known as equicontinuity. So for each epsilon bigger than zero, there is a delta bigger than zero such that distance from xy less than delta will imply that fk of x minus f sub k of y is less than epsilon. That's why I didn't use epsilon there. And by that I mean each fk is uniformly continuous. On x. Therefore the same delta will work for all f. So right, we assume that we are dealing with a compact set X. So as soon as you find that a function is continuous over a compact set, it's right away uniformly continuous. We proved that before. So we can select a delta that is independent of the k. And if we select that delta, then in fact this delta will end up being independent of whichever other f we pick, because all the other f are going to be really similar. And we're going to state that precisely in a moment. Right? So we make the following definitions. So we would say that this family, which is a family of functions f from x to r, we will call this collection uniformly bounded. If supremum over all the functions in the family of the supremum where x belongs to capital X of the absolute value of f of x is less than or equal to some m for some m bigger than 0. So easier way to write it is simply supremum over the functions of the supnorm is less than or equal to m. So this is just saying that that all the terms are not very far from 0. It's a vector space. The 0 function is the origin of that vector space. Correct? And each function is at a distance no more than m. So it's contained in a ball of radius m. Now you remember this space is infinite dimensional, right? It contains all the polynomials, for example. So all the polynomials of degree at most n have dimension n plus 1. So therefore the dimension of the space is infinite. Actually, I should correct myself. I said x, so I don't know what x is. So you have to, actually, I'm not sure if it's finite dimensional or infinite dimensional. That depends on what is x. If x contains, let's say, only 2 points, it's going to be finite. It's going to be finite. No, still going to be infinite dimensional, I think. It's because it's going to get it from R. Well, no matter. That's, by the way, that's a good question. Easy, actually, not a hard question. Figure if x is finite, will the space be infinite dimensional or finite dimensional? See if you can argue that. So the other definition is, so this family f, which is some family of functions from x into R, is said to be equicontinuous if for every epsilon bigger than 0, there is a delta of, the delta will depend on the function that I pick, f, on the point x, and on epsilon, but it will end up being, if it's equicontinuous, it only depends on epsilon. And the condition on this is that distance x to y is smaller than the delta of epsilon. It implies that absolute value of f of x minus f of y is less than epsilon. Examples. Example A, if the sequence is part of the space of continuous functions and it's uniformly convergent to f on x, then the set is compact. Do you see why? Well, this sequence of fn's, it's a Cauchy sequence. Therefore, it is totally bounded. Every Cauchy sequence is totally bounded. Now, because it's a Cauchy sequence and it has a limit, now it's complete. So we have this collection is totally bounded and complete. Therefore, it has to be compact.
And the complete always equals the compact.
Exactly, or in a metric space, right? So the reason you don't hear it in other contexts is because if you don't have a metric space, then there is no sense of totally bounded. How are you going to define totally bounded without a metric space? Maybe there are some, you can think of some generalizations and whatnot, but that's why you don't hear about it. So, yep. Another simple example is that of Lipschitz functions. So if we have k bigger than 0, less than infinity, and we let lip sub k of alpha to be the collection of all f belonging to that satisfy f of x minus f of y is less than or equal to k absolute value x minus y to the power of alpha, then the space of Lipschitz maps is equicontinuous. So equicontinuous, naturally, you see that what should be delta of epsilon here? Equicontinuous is that means that I can specify one delta that works for all those functions. Delta of epsilon, that's an easy test if you understand why it's equicontinuous. write what delta of epsilon is. So it should be exactly epsilon over k, the 1 over alpha, check. Yes, something like that could have been, sure. So, right, they are all uniformly continuous, and this delta works for all of them. The same delta works for all the functions in that space. Now, small question, is this space of Lipschitz functions, is it compact? We know that in example A, we gave an example of a compact set. But about example B, do we have a compact set here? In other words, is it totally bounded? Is it complete?
Well, wouldn't it be totally bounded?
Why? Well, we are, yes, but how does it make the space totally bounded? Remember, where do you measure the distance, right? You can think of, if we're in the space over 0, 1, what we do is we draw a curve over 0, 1, and we measure the biggest displacement from over the y-axis, right? So we draw a graph, and we measure this vertical displacement. Where is this curve farthest from the x-axis? That's the norm of this vector. So the norm of a function is like the graph of this function, and then you find where the curve of the graph of the function is farthest away from the x-axis. That will be the norm. So to ask, is the collection, if you ask, is this bounded, if it's totally bounded, or just even simpler, bounded, it means that if I superimpose all those graphs into one picture, all of them, then it's bounded away from zero if this biggest displacement never blows up to infinity. Make sense? So this is the space of Lipschitz functions. Could you have Lipschitz functions whose graphs climb up to infinity? What examples are there? Well, easiest example, just take a constant map. Take a horizontal line, it's obviously Lipschitz, right? So the answer, it's not compact because it's not bounded. Not compact because not even bounded. Take constant functions. Which are, let's say, f of x equal to c. So you can see, you can draw their graphs. They go up, 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 up. So you can see that it's not bounded, right? You cannot contain in any ball of radius m centered at zero. So it's not bounded.
How do you picture totally bounded in that case?
How do you picture totally bounded? Yeah, good question. Anybody would like to answer? No, it's a good question, wonderful question. So how do you picture a family of functions that is totally bounded? You can always picture their graphs, right? So what you have is, the way I think of it is, here is the interval from 0 to 1, right? And we allow the y-axis to go infinitely far up, infinitely far down. So I have this picture, and I draw all my functions. Right? What should I observe? I should observe that that for any epsilon that I pick, then the curves are gathered in some narrow strips of radius epsilon. And there are only finitely many such strips. So you see, all the graphs that I have are all within some narrow strips, maybe like this, of radius epsilon. Okay? Make sense? It's a little. The picture is not quite as nice. If all the functions were constant, those strips will have horizontal shapes. But if they are not constant, those strips will have different shapes, but there will be only finitely many of them. In other words, I could take this infinite piece of paper and I could cut it into, let's say, five strips. One strip is like this, another strip is here, like this. And if I select a smaller epsilon, maybe I have to cut it into more pieces, more strips, but there will be always finitely many. Okay. So it's compact, and it's not compact because it's not even bounded, so it's not totally bounded. You can, of course, ask, is it a complete space, for example, right? Can I, if I have a sequence of Lipschitz functions, must a sequence of Lipschitz functions converge to a Lipschitz function under this condition, right? So Lipschitz of order k and alpha. So,
what's the answer?
I don't know. I'm just asking questions. You can try it, right? Say, maybe I could have made an exam question like this, right? What is this about? Lemma? If this family is totally bounded, then F is uniformly bounded. And equicontinuous. Proof. So we kind of sketched it in our earlier derivations, but let's just give a formal proof of it. So since this family is totally bounded, it is bounded, so there is nothing to prove here. Right? So it's obviously uniformly bounded. We already did it before. So the only interesting part is to show that it's equicontinuous. That this family is equicontinuous. You pick epsilon bigger than zero, and let F1 through Fn be the epsilon over 3 net. So you all remember what epsilon over 3 net is. It means that every function in this family, capital F, it's going to be within, each term is going to be within epsilon over 3 away from one of them, right? So they are basically n strips, and each strip is the shape of f1, f2, f3, fn, and the functions are all, the graphs are in the strips. So the graph of every f is either in the strip for f1 or the strip of f2, etc., right? So since x is compact, each function is uniformly continuous. Let delta be small. Small enough such that distance x to y less than delta implies the distance between fkx and fky is smaller than epsilon over 3 for all k equal 1 all the way to n. Then for any f in the family, and distance from x to y is smaller than delta, we have that f of x minus f of y is less than or equal to the distance of f of x minus f kx plus the distance of f kx to f ky plus the distance f ky to f of y. And this is less than epsilon over 3 plus epsilon over 3 plus epsilon over 3, which is epsilon. And of course, where fk is such that f minus f sub k is less than epsilon over 3. So the idea is we really have essentially only finitely many functions to compare with, right? So the fact that I selected an epsilon over 3 net means that every function that is not listed here is essentially like the one listed here. So what I can do is I can pick a uniform delta 1 for f1, delta 2 for f2, delta 3 for f sub 3 and onwards. And then I take the minimum of those finitely many deltas. That will be a delta that works for this collection. Okay? Now if it works for this collection, then just if you pick any other guy, any other water gun is very similar to the n water guns listed here. So its prey is going to be controlled by that, right? So precisely here is what we mean, right? So controlled by that, it means that this guy is uniformly within epsilon over 3. This is epsilon over 3 because of the delta we picked, and this is again within epsilon over 3 for the same reason as the first guy. Okay, by uniform convergence, by uniform approximation. So there's no limit here, so no convergence, but by uniform approximation. It makes sense, I hope, right? No? It's a very, very difficult theorem, so if it makes no sense, that's what I was worried about. I even until today, I considered, should I do something simple? Because I, you know, give you some true-false questions that I have from before. That's not yet the Arzela-Ascoli theorem. That's just an easy part for it. Any questions? You get the idea here?
Yeah, I'm a little confused how you chose
the three. Really, you could have chosen epsilon net, but then you would get estimate to within epsilon. It's because of the strangle inequality, because we have this part. That's where the three comes in. So I want to verify that this delta will make the spray within epsilon. So f of x and f of y will be mapped to within epsilon away from each other. So they used to be initially within delta away from each other. Their images will be within epsilon away from each other. Okay? So it's really just like the proof for uniform continuity, but we only have we have delta that works for f1, f2, f3, fn. And then we want to say that the same delta will work for the other guys. So that's then the way the argument goes.